How does trauma affect the brain? There is a scientific reason why your brain responds to trauma the way it does. Anytime we talk about neuroscience or the brain's response to trauma, I like to call it the "you're not crazy" part. Because when you are in the sea of confusion caused by trauma, not understanding what happened to you, why it happened, and why you react the way you do feel like you are crazy. This is further perpetuated by the fact that quite often you have internalized the trauma, meaning you might feel that it is your fault or you should have done more to stop it. Suicidal ideation may even creep in. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist. Here's the neuroscience of what's going on and why you are not crazy. Your nervous system has three levels of dealing with threats. Whenever you feel threatened, you instinctively turn to the first level, social engagement. You call out for help, support, and comfort from the people around you. But if no one comes to your aid, or you're in immediate danger, you revert to a more primitive way to survive: fight or flight. You fight off an attacker, or you run to a safe place. However, if this fails, you can't get away, you're held down or trapped, or feel you are unable to protect yourself. You preserve yourself by shutting down and expending as little energy as possible. At that point, you are in a state of freeze or collapse. This last stage often happens if the abuse or trauma is repeated without the ability to escape. An example would be if the abuse is caused by a parent, caretaker, or someone in a position of trust. This type of trauma, caused by repeat events instead of one-time events, falls into the category of C, PTSD, or complex post-traumatic stress disorder. To recap, your brain's three stages of dealing with threats are call for help, fight or flight, collapse or freeze. When one experiences trauma, whether emotional, mental, physical, or sexual, and if during the experience of that trauma you are unable to run away or protect yourself, you are designed to freeze. You might collapse, disengage, or dissociate during this freeze response. To dissociate means to disconnect from things you were once connected to, whether that is relationships, meaningful experiences, or even daily life. If there's no way out and there's nothing you can do to stave off the inevitable, you will activate the ultimate emergency system and shut down. This literally affects the stomach, kidneys, intestines, and drastically reduces metabolism throughout the body. Heart rate plunges, we feel our heart drop. We can't breathe, your gut stops working, and your bowels might be affected. There's absolutely a connection between trauma and the manifestation of physical symptoms. Dr. Bessel van der Kolk explains it this way in The Body Keeps the Score. When fighting or running does not take care of the threat, we activate the last resort, the reptilian brain, the ultimate emergency system. This system is most likely to engage when we are physically immobilized, as when we are pinned down by an attacker, or when a child has no escape from a terrifying caregiver. Collapse and disengagement are controlled by the DVC, a part of the parasympathetic nervous system that is associated with digestive symptoms like diarrhea and nausea. It also slows down the heart and induces shallow breathing. Once this system takes over, other people, and we ourselves, cease to matter. Awareness is shut down, and we may no longer even register physical pain. It is important to understand that after trauma, you experience the world with a different nervous system. When something reminds you of the past, your right brain reacts as if the traumatic event were happening in the present. But because the left side of your brain is not working very well, you may not be aware that you are re-experiencing and reenacting the past. You may be furious, terrified, enraged, ashamed, or frozen, stuck in one of the three levels you experienced when the traumatic event actually happened. We have learned that trauma is not just an event that took place sometime in the past, it is also the mark left by that experience on mind, brain, and body. The trauma affects our mental, emotional, and physical health. This mark has ongoing consequences for how the individual manages to survive in the present. Trauma results in a fundamental reorganization of the way the mind and brain manage perceptions, or how we interpret our experiences. It challenges not only how we think and what we think about, but also our very capacity to think. If you've experienced a trauma, while finding the words to describe what has happened to you can be profoundly meaningful, it is often not enough. The act of telling the story doesn't necessarily alter the automatic physical and hormonal responses of your mind and body, which remain hypervigilant, prepared to be assaulted or violated at any time. For real change to take place, the body and mind need to learn that the danger has passed and to live in the present. Dr. Van der Kolk puts it this way: traumatized people keep secreting large amounts of stress hormones long after the actual danger has passed. Ideally, our stress hormone system should provide a lightning-fast response to threat, but then quickly return us to equilibrium. In PTSD patients, however, the stress hormone system fails at this balancing act. Fight or flight or freeze signals continue after the danger is over and do not return to normal. Instead, the continued secretion of stress hormones is expressed as agitation and panic, which in the long term wreaks havoc with their health. Our body is an amazing creation, versatile and diverse. Designed to keep us safe, we have a warning system. When we are in danger, signals through stress hormones are sent to our brain. These signals provide a lightning-fast response to threats. Like when a car in front of you slams on their brakes, you feel a rush of emotions and quickly brake to avoid an accident. For me, this feels like a pulsing in my head, a wave of heat through my entire body, and my breathing gets faster. For a person not affected by trauma, you quickly return to a place of calm and continue going throughout your day. The car in front of you in this example can be compared to trauma triggers. You are going throughout your day and out of nowhere there are red brake lights. You are in danger. It could be a smell, a song, a color, a name, or someone that reminds you of someone else. In an instant, you are back in that unsafe and vulnerable place. The hardest part? No one else sees the brake lights. Everyone else goes about their day as if nothing is happening. For those who live with PTSD, the proverbial car slams on their brakes. You experience a trauma trigger that no one else sees or relates to. Your warning system goes off and then does not go back to a place of balance and calm. Instead, stress hormones stay elevated. Danger signals continue to flood your entire system repeatedly, day after day, for weeks, months, and years on end. In the long term, this cycle wreaks havoc on your health. Dr. Van der Kolk explains it this way: after trauma, the world is experienced with a different nervous system. The survivor's energy now becomes focused on suppressing inner chaos at the expense of spontaneous involvement in their life. These attempts to maintain control over unbearable physiological reactions can result in a whole range of physical symptoms, including fibromyalgia, chronic fatigue, and other autoimmune diseases. This explains why it is critical for trauma treatment to engage the entire body, mind, and brain. This understanding of experiencing a trauma and subsequently living in a world of PTSD is not often understood by those who have not experienced it. Dr. Van der Kolk describes it this way: after trauma, the world becomes sharply divided between those who know and those who don't. People who have not shared the traumatic experience cannot be trusted because they can't understand it. Sadly, this often includes spouses, children, and coworkers. One of the biggest gifts you can give yourself is understanding. I go over these points of trauma not to overwhelm or be a downer, but for understanding, understanding for yourself. While this may be your life and you know what it's like to live it, you may not know it is completely reasonable for you to have certain responses. They are trauma responses. Brené Brown said, "There is incredible relief and power in naming and normalizing fear and uncertainty. And trauma and stress experienced after trauma is nothing if not uncertain and fearful. As we better understand what we are going through, that increases our ability to communicate our experience, have compassion for ourselves, and create understanding with spouses, children, and loved ones. The support and understanding from a community is critical in healing. The love and understanding that our community shows us becomes a mirror and an example of how to love and accept others. It is no longer a club of who is in and who is out." Now, I want to hear from you. Down below in the comments, how has trauma affected you? What helps you to cope? How do you take the power back? Or if you have questions for us about coping with the effects of trauma and taking your power back, let us know in the comments below and we'll address them. If you enjoy what we're doing here, please hit the subscribe button and the bell so that you can get our new videos. Here at Mended Light, we're invested in helping you heal yourself so that your light can shine to the world, so that you can be the happiest, best version of you. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist, and I'll see you next time.